All right, so our third lecture in thermal radiation, there's a lot of things we already covered. Do you know the definition of the view factor? Can you write down that equation? It's really helpful at times. We don't use that equation very often, but it's nice to know that you can analytically calculate it by double area integral. What we use all the time are two relations. They are the summation rule, the sum of all the view factors for any surface I in an enclosure to all other surfaces J. Actually, I is included in that. All sum over all the J's must equal to 1. The photons have to go somewhere. And then the other is reciprocity. A, I, F, I to J is equal to A, J, F, J to I. Then we talked about radiation exchange first, about black bodies. You could have a network of black bodies. And then we were introduced to the concept of a radiative geometrical resistance. That formula was 1 over AF. 1 over AF. And it could be 1 over AI, FI to J, or AJ, FJ back to I. Either one. They work because of reciprocity. And then last time we had the resistance in a network where everything's not black anymore, but it's gray and diffuse. Hence, we have a surface resistance due to the emissivity not being 1. So we have 1 minus epsilon over epsilon A. Well, let's press forward. So if you have two surface enclosures where they're gray, what you'll have is you could have, let's say, surface 1, make it really easy, then surface 2. And what I'd have is I'd have an EB node for surface 1. What is that EB node? It's a emissive power or flux and goes out to a J1 node. J1 is the radiosity for surface 1. Then it goes over to a radiosity node for surface 2. Then it goes over to EB2, which is the black body emissive flux for surface 2. These EVs, are they given by sigma T to the fourth, the Stefan Boltzmann law? Yes, they are. What are the traditional SI units for these black body emissive fluxes? Watts per meter squared. And the units a lot of times will keep you from making a mistake. Now, is this also over here, is this equal to sigma T1 to the fourth? So if I know the temperatures, then I know the EB net values? Yeah. And then you show Q coming into node 1, Q coming into node 2, but from a conservation of energy, you know maybe Q2 is equal to negative Q1. One of them is negative. They're equal magnitude, and just one is the opposite sign of the other. What are these resistances? This is the 1 minus epsilon over epsilon A for surface 1. 1 minus epsilon over epsilon A for surface 2. And this is the 1 over AF, maybe A1, F1 to 2. And so that's a very simple network where you have both the geometrical, this is resistance due to the geometry, as well as the surface resistance, surface radiative surface resistances. Let's solve a problem. We have a cone drilled hole that's drilled into a large block of aluminum. The cone depth is 0.1 meter. The radius at the opening is 0.025. So this is our block of aluminum. We have a cone drilled like that. And the center goes like this. And so you're given a radius R equal to 0.025 meters and a depth H equal to 0.1 meter. That's an H. All right. The sides of the cone are diffuse and gray with emissivity 0.5. So we'll say, okay, this is the interior is surface 1, has emissivity 1 of 0.5 and a temperature 1 of 1,000 Kelvin. A black disk at 500 Kelvin covers the hole. So some disk covers the hole. The surface is surface 2. Its emissivity for surface 2 is 1 because it's black. And the temperature 2 is 500 Kelvin. That's the disk that covers the hole. Calculate the rate of heat transfer from the cone surface to the covering disk. So, just like back in Thermo One or back in statics, what exactly are we asked to calculate? What symbol should I adopt for the unknown that I'm calculating, and what are the SI units for that symbol? So this one's not too hard. I'm looking to calculate Q in units of watt. And we know where the high temperature is, that's surface one, and the low temperature, so I would not need the additional subscripts. But if it was confusing, I'd add the subscripts. Let's go ahead and make a network. So the network may have, let me put, the, because the cone is going down, I'm going to put an EB1 here and an EB2 there. Okay. Then I have, do I have a surface resistance associated with the cone interior surface 1? Yeah, so let's put that in. That's 1 minus epsilon over epsilon A1. And then, so that's out to J1. Radiosity node for surface one. Do I have a radius or surface resistance for the surface two? No, I don't. So I put 1 minus epsilon over epsilon A in the, for all two, but what happens when the emissivity is 1 for a black surface? What happens to this resistor? It collapses. So what's the difference in the numeric value between the J2 node, the radiosity for surface 2, and the blackbody emissive flux for surface 2? They're equal. So a lot of times we'll even just skip putting that resistor in, and we'll just say, hey, somehow J2 is equal to EB2. But I have to have another resistor between them. That's my geometrical resistance, 1 over A1 F1 to 2. Okay. Well, it looks like I'm going to need to get some of the areas and view factors. So maybe over here on the side, I say, let's do the area for 1. Well, that's the inner surface of that cone-shaped hole, right? And so you look that up. That's probably not one that you have memorized, okay? So it'll be pi times r times S, where S is the length of the edge from the outer radius to the tip of the cone. And S is probably hypotenuse of a right triangle, going to be R squared plus H squared. Does that look good? So if you make the calculation, the area for surface 1 is 0.0080957 meters squared. Keep a lot of digits, right? All right. The easy one is area 2. That's pi r squared. And that area comes in at 0.0019635 meters squared. So that's area 2. So I have the two areas. Now, how about at least one of those view factors, and then we'll get the other view factor. Which view factor is the easiest to get? From 2 back to 1. So the view factor from 2 back to 1 is 1. Now, how do I get the view factor 1 to 2? Reciprocity. Reciprocity, right? So it would be A1 F1 to 2 is equal to A2, F2 to 1. Hence, F1 to 2 is simply A2 divided by A1 times F2 to 1, which we know is unity. And when you put those two areas in, we calculate the view factor 1 to 2 is 0.24254. About 1/4, 0.25. Close enough to 0.25 if you want to round it off. That means 75% of the photons which are emitted off of surface 1 just strike surface 1. Only 25% get out and hit the lid, which is the covering dome or the covering disk that covers the hole. All right, so we could come in here and we could actually put in a numeric value for the A1 and F12, and we could do that. And then you find out that this is 509.30. What are the units on that resistance? 1 over meter squared. And this resistance, 1 minus the emissivity of 0.5 divided by 0.5, and then the area comes in at 123.52, 1 over meter squared. If we sum them, the sum of the R's, the resistances, thermal resistance is 632.82, 1 over meter squared. And then I like to go back and say, hey, this accounts for 80% of the resistance. This accounts for roughly 20% of the resistance. Make sense? Ready for a clicker question? So if the emissivity of surface 1 goes down, how will the sum of the R's change? The sum of the R's. Will it go up? Answer A. Stay about the same? Answer B. Or go down? Answer C. So I'm saying the emissivity of surface 1, if that goes down, how will this R, the sum of the R's, change? Ready to grade it? So let's check it out. Well, pretty much everybody's correct, right? So it kind of goes back to this. What happened to the resistance up here when the emissivity of surface 2 was 1? Emissivity 2 was 1. What happened to that resistance? It went to 0. No resistance. So as the emissivity goes down, what does the resistance do for the surface resistance? It goes up, 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 up. And then that's going to linearly add to the overall resistance. So answer A was the correct answer. Right. Very good. You're awake. That was pretty good. So let's go ahead and just solve for Q. Q is equal to EB1, which is greater than EB2. You divide that by the sum of those R's. And those EB1 is just a sigma T1 to the fourth. EB2 is sigma T2 to the fourth. You just have to know the Stefan-Boltzmann constant. What is sigma? Times 10 to the minus 8th watts per meter squared Kelvin to the fourth. Professor, are there some additional digits on that number, or is it just like the end, you know? There's more out there, but this radiation heat transfer, you don't know the emissivity that well. So stop at 3 significant digits. And then we calculate this Q, and we find that that Q comes in at 84.0 watts. Do you want another clicker question? Sure, go for it. So if the temperature of 1 goes down, what happens to Q? Does it go up? Answer A. Stay about the same? Answer B. Or go down? Answer C. What happens to the rate of heat transfer if the T1 goes down? It was 1,000. Maybe it goes to 950. Or maybe it goes to 900 Kelvin. So we always remember that the EB is what drives the radiative transfer. The black body emissive flux. It's equal to sigma times T to the fourth. Well, if temperature goes up, you got a stronger EB. So this was going to go up. This was unchanged. You're going to get a larger Q. I think everybody was pretty well on. Oh, it goes down. Yeah, yeah. The T goes down. The black body emissive flux goes down. The delta T, the difference in the EBs goes down, etc. Very good. Better questions. How about some better ones? All right. If the emissivity of the cone is changed from 0.5 to 0.8, the rate of heat transfer from the cone surface to the hole will increase, not change significantly or decrease. Didn't I already do this one? Go for it. It's an easy one. Yeah, here it is for Q. How will the rate of heat transfer Q change? You only have 15 seconds. All right. Well, if the emissivity goes from 0.5 to 0.8, isn't it getting closer to being black? Black is better at transferring radiative energy. Low emissivity is worse. So when the emissivity is going to change like that, the resistance of that one surface, the first surface, won't that go down? The sum of the R's will go down. And then you have Q is equal to a difference in EBs divided by the sum of the R's. The sum of the R's goes down. It's easier to transfer the heat. Q goes up. True? All you have to do is keep asking questions and it'll trip students up. I hate that, don't you? Let's try another one. Okay, I think I already did this. We already did that. Let's continue on. We have two very large parallel plates that are gray and diffuse. So the surfaces behave as if they're gray and diffuse. The top plate is at 1,200 Kelvin. So, and the bottom plate's at 400 Kelvin. Emissivity of the first plate top is 1 and then 0.8. So we draw it like this. And we'll say that this surface is 1, and the temperature 1 is 1200 Kelvin, and the emissivity 1 is 1.0, so it's black. And here's the other plate, and it's surface 2 with the temperature 2 of 400 Kelvin, emissivity 2 of 0.8. Calculate the net radiation exchange per unit area between the two plates. Well, we'll draw a network, right? So we'll start with this one. We'll call this one EB1. But we know that this it's a black surface, so that's also equal to J1, isn't it? And so then the only thing, we immediately come out to a 1 over A1 F1 to 2 geometrical resistance down to J2. Then we have the 1 minus epsilon 2 over epsilon 2 A2. And then we're going to have EB2. Okay, and because it's hot, we'll draw the Q in from there, and I won't even draw Q2. There's just one Q. Calculate the net radiation exchange per unit area between the plates. So we're asked to solve for Q double prime in units of watts per meter squared. We can write the equation, but what's the difference if I have two parallel plates like this between, let's say, A1 and A2? They're the same. It's not like the inner diameter of a pipe and outer diameter of a pipe, and they depend on the diameters. No. So Q, I'll just write it and then modify it to get the flux, is going to be EB1 minus EB2 divided by 1 over A1 F1 to 2 plus 1 minus epsilon 2 over epsilon 2 A2. We then get rid of the designation on the areas. We can bring that area out, and by algebra, it goes Q over area is equal to, so that gives us the flux, like that. Make sense? Okay. So now what do we do is we'll go ahead and stick in our numbers. This is sigma times our 1200 to the fourth minus 400 to the fourth, and then 1 over 1 plus 1 minus 0.8 divided by 0.8. And if I focus on the denominator, that's 1 plus 0.2 divided by 0.8, 0.25. So basically, sigma T to the fourth minus T to the fourth, and then you divide by 1.25. So you can see that the surface resistance accounts for 0.25 divided by 1.25, whatever, 30-some percent. I forget what percent, what fraction it is, but it's not dominant. The dominant is just the one, right, as a resistance. So we calculate that Q double prime comes in to 92.9 kilowatts, or leave off the kilo, comma, 9,000 watts per meter squared. Sometimes I'll put the kilo in there, sometimes I won't. One thing, if you put a kilo, sometimes you forget about the kilo, and then you got a factor of 10 to the 3 error. All right. Let's take a look at part B. What is the radiosity for the top plate, J1? I'm going to pause. I'm going to walk around and see if you can calculate J1. So we get that it's simply sigma T1 to the fourth, and when you run the number, J1 is 117,500 watts per meter squared. I truncate to 4 significant digits. Or maybe that's a 6, not a 5. Yeah, a 6. Very good. Now, what about the irradiation for the top surface? What symbol do we use for irradiation? G. And what units for irradiation? Watts per meter squared, just like J, and then watts per meter squared. So what is, how are we going to calculate for that? I'm going to give you a minute. Sorry, I can't give you more time. I'm looking at the clock. There's 3 ways of doing it. 2 will work, 1 will end in a dead end, and you'll get stuck. Do you want to see the dead end first or last? First, dead end, let's go for the dead end. What we do is we take a look at what is the basic, I'm going to try and fit them in down here. What is the definition, DEFN, of J? What's the definition of J? Because J had in it G, didn't it? So you think about the outgoing from surface 1 is due to the emission from surface 1, and a reflectance from surface 1 of what? The incident coming into surface 1, true? That won't work in this case. The reason it won't work is, what is the emissivity for surface 1? It's black. Okay? What is the rho for surface 1? No, it's opaque surface. It's opaque surface, okay? Yeah, what is reflectivity if it's black? Zero. And so guess what? G's not into our equation for the definition of J when it's a black. That's why this won't work. Then J is just EB1. J1 is just EB1. So that won't work. But you can do an energy balance. Let me try and do this. You can do an energy balance for the node. All right, so if I take a look at the energy balance, I still have alpha 1 times G1 is coming into the surface 1. That's what's actually being absorbed. Plus, I have some Q double prime flux from the backside of surface 1, some conduction and other things. You know, we just solved for that. We already know that's 92,900 watts per meter squared. That's the both the ins for surface 1, and the only out would be the emission. Now you say to yourself, okay, what is the emissivity for surface 1? 1. So it's just EB1 times 1. Q double prime 1, we just solved for that. What's the absorptivity for surface 1? 1, because it's black. And so I know it's tricky, but G1 is equal to EB1 minus Q double prime 1, or Q double prime. And wasn't this EB1? And so it's 117,600 minus 92,900. The solution is G1 is 24,700 watts per meter squared. All right, there's one other way to solve for this G1. How am I going to do it? I focus on, there's only another surface 2 in this enclosure. And guess what comes off the 2 is what goes to 1. So if I could get J2, isn't that G1? Yeah. So then you just go down and you work on getting J2. All right, which ones do you want? Do you want this one? Fine, we'll just go for it. If the emissivity of the bottom plate is changed, it was 0.8, but now we're going to change it to 0.5. The radiosity for the top plate, J sub 1, will increase, not change significantly, or decrease. 30 seconds. What about the top surface? Is it black? If I change the emissivity of the bottom plate, will that change the blackness of the top plate? No. So J1 is just DB1. Doesn't matter. Hey, what are we doing? We're guessing. Isn't it? It's not going to change? Is that right, the answer? Do you agree? I agree. Okay. You want more of these? They're humbling, huh? If the temperature of the bottom plate is changed, it was 400 Kelvin, but now we're going to change it to 500 Kelvin. The radiosity for the top plate will... All right, well, this is a very similar. Did the top plate, it was black, is it still black? Did the temperature of the top plate change? Nope, guess what? EB1 is J1. It only depends on the temperature. So, we're catching on, right? You want another one, huh? You prove your score. If the temperature of the bottom plate is changed, the irradiation for the top plate will increase, not change significantly, or decrease. What will happen to G1? All right, the best way to think of it, I hate to say it, is what I just was mentioning before, is that the J of 2 is equal to the G sub 1. Is that true or false? And now, what does J2 depend on? It depends on the emissivity of 2, EB2, that's the emission part, plus the reflectivity of 2 times the G of 2, which is J1. But what's happening when we increase the temperature of the bottom plate? Doesn't this go up, EB2? And we're leaving alone other components, so J2 goes up, G1 goes up. All right, last question. It's not a clicker question, but it's a question nonetheless. How can the heat transfer between these two plates be reduced? Right now, we have a Q double prime of 92.9 kilowatts per meter squared. We don't want to change the T's. We don't want to change the E's, but I want to reduce the heat transfer. It's a vacuum already. There's no convection or conduction, just photons going back and forth. Can't change the T's. How can you reduce that heat transfer? I hear a lot of good answers. Okay, let's leave the emissivity 1 alone and the emissivity 2 alone. Not change the temperature of the two surfaces or change their emissivities. They're two infinite parallel plates. Somebody had some words that I liked, but it was close. What were they? Put in a shield. Put in a radiant shield. What exactly is a radiant shield? You have it in everybody's kitchen. Foil. Rip it off. Put a little shiny piece of foil in there. What's that going to do? It's going to significantly reduce the thermal load, the radiative heat transfer. How much? By how much? Well, take a look. I know that this is our top plate and our bottom plate. If we just put a piece of foil in there, what does it do to the radiative network, not changing the temperatures or the emissivity of the top or bottom plate? Don't we start with EB1 equal to J1, and I need to renumber these. I'm going to call this 1, surface 2, surface 3, and surface 4. Hold it. This foil has two sides to it, so it has two surfaces. It sure does. But it has one temperature. It has one temperature. All right. So we're going to go from this one down to J2. Isn't that the radiosity node for surface 2? And then we're going to go to EB2. Then we're going to go to what? Are we going to go, is this node going to be J3 or EB3? Answer A or B. What should be that node? All right. So let me ask this. What is the difference in the temperature to the surface, side 2 of the surface versus side 3 of the surface? Does the foil have a different temperature on either side of our aluminum foil sheet? It has the same temperature. How do I calculate EB2? Is it simply sigma times T2 to the fourth? How do I calculate EB3? Sigma T3 to the fourth? Well, then EB2 is equal to EB3. So there's no resistance to radiative transfer because the same temperature is the same emissive fluxes. This is J3 is our right node. Well, I didn't ask to embarrass you, but there you go. There you go. True? All right. Now, once we're out, we have a resistance down to J4 and then a resistance down to EB4. So this is a 1 minus epsilon. No, it's not. We don't have any surface resistance for the black top plate. It's 1 over AF, 1 minus epsilon over epsilon A, 1 minus epsilon over epsilon A, 1 over AF, 1 minus epsilon over epsilon A. You added one piece of foil. This is what you added. How many new resistors showed up? Two or three new resistors. New, and we got three new resistors. So a piece of foil, you think, how's that going to reduce the heat transfer? It's going to reduce it significantly. Thank you for your attention. We'll pick up there next time. Thank you.